And good afternoon, everyone. So this is going to be the last session on this series. And also the session just before the lunch. Mainly in this session, we are planning to discuss about WSO2 platform and why we need extensions, and also about more details on WSO2 public store. And I'll be going in details about enterprise service bus extensions and identity server extensions. And finally, how you can contribute and what are the benefits for contributing into this base. So as you're already aware, so WSO2 provides a complete solution for middleware. Using these products, you can build platforms in order to build solutions on top of it. So whatever the domain you are from, so there are maybe reference architectures where you can build a platform and provide solutions for your users or customers. So why do we need extension points? So basically, with the WSO2 products, you can build a platform. But the platform itself does not solve your problem. So you need to do some customization in order to provide a solution. So we make it easy for you by providing ready-made extensions as well as providing complete extension points to your products. So when you are talking about extensions, there are two aspects. So the product itself should have a distinct, clear extension where you can make use of this extension point. And also there should be a place, as the second point, there should be a place where you can share your generic solution so that customers can or users can reuse it. So what are the advantages of this model? Basically, using WSO2 products, you can just build a platform and you can just put the final touch using these extensions. So the advantages of this model is, so let's say you want a new feature or an improvement. So typically, if you don't have this model, you have to wait for the next product version. So which is, at WSO2, we practice the releasing of products in every 6 months. But again, migration is an issue. So it's a big headache for customers. Right? So you have to do all these rounds of testing and it's quite expensive. So with this model, so you don't really have to wait for your new feature until the next product version. So you can rather install on your existing deployment and reuse it. So basically, we are releasing these extensions completely different from these product life cycles and on demand. And also, we are trying to focus on a custom use case. So if your problem comes into this same use case, you can really make use of these ready-made extensions. And also, you can make your development and deployment more agile. So you can just introduce one feature at a time in each iteration. So that way you can build your complete system in agile fashion. And also the important fact is most of these extensions are talking to external systems and mainly SaaS applications. So there's a high chance that these SaaS applications or these providers change their API. So if this happens, so you have to either wait for a patch of our product or wait for the next version of the product. With this beauty of this model is that you don't have to wait for that. So we continuously monitor this. And if there is such a change, we release another version of these extensions where you can directly use it. So this is the snapshot of our WSO2 public store. So you can access it using the following URL. So this is purely available for public. We don't have a commercial and a community version for this. So as well as the source code is available publicly. And also there's a discussion. You can also discuss and give feedback about these individual extensions. And this is running on our enterprise store, which is also another WSO2 product. So what we do is we practice internally in WSO2. We try to get the experience as customers. Our products, so that way we can improve the usability of our products. So even with the connectors, so we are using a lot of systems internally like Salesforce, Redmine, Jira. So even internal integrations, we use this product. Even for authentication, we are using our identity server with custom authenticators. Okay, so let's first talk about the extensions that are available for Enterprise Service Bus. So Enterprise Service Bus is itself is a high performance and a future-edge ESB in the market today. So you can see it from the global discussions that are happening. So this Enterprise Service Bus, you have the basically two main points. That is your incoming and your outgoing path. So we there are like clear extensions you can write for this path. Like for example, if you want to talk with a third party or SaaS application, there's a concept called connector. So you can have that connector talking to that specific API. So this was introduced since ESP 480, which is like released 2 years back. So we now have a base around like up to date. Today we have like 157 connectors in the store. So if your integration is related to that API, you can straight away use it. And also on the listening side, we have another new concept called inbounds, where you can just listen to some external events. So basically, this concept was introduced with the ESP 490, which is the latest version of Enterprise Service Bus. So the generic inbounds such as file, VFS, and all these things comes out of the box. But if you have a specific use case, there's going to be some custom ready-made inbounds in the store. You can directly use it. Okay, so this is the high-level architecture of Enterprise Service Bus. On top and left corner, you will see these are the message triggering points that are available with ESB. And inbound is one of those. So you can just extend it and have your own triggering point if you like. And also this connector comes into that category. So if you are like familiar with our Enterprise Service Bus, you may know that mediator is the basic element you need in order to configure a mediation flow. So collection of these mediators we call as sequences. So the connectors, you can all same applies for connectors. So you can straight away use those connectors in your sequences. So when it comes to implementing this connector, so it can be vary. So let's say you are talking to a SOAP or REST API. So in that case, so you can use out-of-the-box mediators and write your implementation of the connector. So let's say your provider has send you a Java SDK, then you have to write Java code, then you can implement your connector using Java. So whatever the way you do with your connector implementation, you can expose these as operations with set of parameters. So you can directly use this as a mediator in your sequences. So this is similar to like just calling an operation using Java interfaces. You really don't care about the implementation, you just invoke it. So directly we are using the channel adapter in enterprise integration patterns, one of the integration patterns in here. Okay, now let's say the connectors makes your integration faster. Let's take a real life example. Let's say now you want to expose an API getting some information from Salesforce. I think most of you are familiar with Salesforce here, right? So in that case, let's say if you are going to do it without connectors, then you have to learn about Salesforce. Then you have to see what are the APIs that are available with Salesforce. Let's say you have decided to go with partner SOAP API. Then you have to download the WSDL. Then you have to see what are the available methods for me to get some information from Salesforce. You have found some method operation called query. Then you have to see what is the payload I need. And what is the endpoint I have to, there are a lot of things you have to do in order to just do a one call. But if you are using our ESP, you simply have to do is just install the connector and these four lines, and it will do the query for you. So that makes the integration really fast. And how do you know that four lines? You can just refer our documentation. There are enough samples and a lot of explaining in that documentation. So we keep on improving the documents so you can make it very fast for integration. So it is much more also user-friendly with this approach, tooling. So ESP comes with the tooling. So with the next version of releases, it will come with the product. There's going to be a specific tooling for that. So with that, you can just simply do everything within the tool itself. You don't have to even touch the server. So you can simply browse through the store within the tool itself and go through all the connectors that are available, and you can just select whatever you are interested in your integration use case, then you can just add it. Then it will be available in the palette. So you can see what are the operations that are available for me to do the integration. Then you can just drag and drop these operations and you are ready to run. So in a few seconds. And also if you are like having more integration scenario with more than one API, so you can simply use the data mapper which will be released with the ESP5 and simply do your data mapping at element levels. So, and also you can just bundle everything in a one application and deploy it. So you can either run it on your local machine, and also in coming days, we are going to release the integration cloud, which is iPaaS-based integration. So if you can even use this same configuration to run it on cloud. Okay, so that's about the outbound part. Now let's talk about inbound part. Let's say now you want to have your use cases, something that you like, whenever there's an opportunity or some record gets updated in Salesforce, you want to inform your marketing people on that. So these type of scenarios can be easily handled with inbound endpoints. So currently we have a couple of inbound endpoints that is listening for events on Salesforce as well as Twitter. So you can just register an inbound endpoint, and whenever there's event occurs, you can just it'll invoke a sequence in ESP mediator. So with this sequence, you can do whatever you want. So let's say you want to send a mail, you use a Gmail connector and send the mail to marketing people. Let's say it's an urgent alert, then you have to send SMS, use the Twilio connector for that. So there are many options you can use when it comes to this inbounds and connectors. So, and if this is not covering your requirement and your requirement is only specific to you, so you can write your own custom inbound endpoint. So we have enough support to do that in this documentation with samples. So you can just write your own inbound, and this can fall under any category like polling, listening, or event-based inbounds. So that's about enterprise service bus. Now let's move on to identity server. So identity server is the open source identity and entitlement management server. So this out of the box, you will get lot of support for open standards. So with IS 510, you have main extension point for inbound authentication, outbound authentication, and outbound provisioning. So by make using of these endpoints, we have created a couple of ready-made extensions for you. So why do we need to like extend the identity server? So the first use case is you want your users to come from different domains or external systems. So that is what we call bring your own identity. And maybe in your authentication flow, service providers wants to like have some additional step to enforce strong authentication. So in that case, we call it two-factor authenticator or multi-factor authenticator. And also, with scenario-driven configuration, you can simply change the configuration without affecting service provider or identity provider sides. And there are a large number of scenarios supported out of the box with the open standards, and further you can expand it with ready-made extensions. Okay, so let's talk about federated authenticators. So we have a couple of, I think there are a lot of O2-based authenticators that are currently available on our store. So this includes Amazon, Twilio, and Office 365. So using those, you can implement the bring your own identity use cases with WSO2 identity server. So another important thing is that multi-option authentication. So most of the time, so users don't like to have multiple logins for different applications. So they tend to log in with whatever they have. So I personally prefer that. So I think that's the case with most of the users. So in that case, with the availability of authenticators in our store, you can give more options to your user to log into your service provider, or rather your system. Okay, so the next step, next one is the multi-factor authentication. So this is a way you enforce your strong authentication on for service providers. So that way, in this example, I have given an example of Clef Authenticator. So what, here what happens is, in the on the first step, user enters their username and password, and there's going to be enrollment step, where they are register or associate their user, local user with your application on your mobile phone. So that's the first step. The second step is, whenever he or she logs in, they put the username and password, then it will show that dancing wave, which is nothing but a QR code. So you only will be authenticated once you just scan that code using your own mobile. So similar to that, we have a lot of authenticators. So mainly we are covering the mobile-based two-factoring as well as hardware tokens. And there are some local authenticators like SMS, OTP. And also some, if you want to allow a user to only logging using a specific machine or specific device, we have an authenticator for X0509 certificates. So there are many options, and there's going to be a couple of new interesting authenticators like RSA and on our roadmap. Okay, so let's talk about provisioning. So there are two use cases when it comes to identity provisioning. So the first use case is, if you are using federated authenticator, there's always requirement that you persist your users to local store. So we call this as shadow accounts. The main purpose of this of doing that is just to authorize as well as maintain profiles. So in this case, you can just enable just-in-time provisioning, which is an option that is given for federated authenticators. You can simply persist by just clicking that. So the other use case is, so provisioning to external systems. So you can just create users in identity server using admin console or our API or using scheme protocol. So if you want to persist the same user to external system, we can use connectors, provisioning connectors to do that. So currently we have connectors for Salesforce as well as for InWebOS, and there's going to be more on our roadmap. Okay, so what's on our roadmap? So currently we are continuously monitoring these extensions, and if there are any API changes, we are putting a new version, and we are in the continuous process of improving these extensions for Enterprise Service Bus and Identity. In addition to that, we are working on some extensions for Complex Event Processor, which is also another WSO2 product, where you can analyze statistics or real time, so you can invoke some queries on the input stream. And so this comes with a known language called Siddhi, so we are writing some extensions for this in order to provide you more options on that. And also we are working on some extensions on analytics side, where you can just, currently we are only focusing on without extension, we are only focusing on integrating analytics within our own platform, but there's always requirement to publish and receive from outsiders. So outside our third party products. So we are planning to do that as well. And also on BPS side, we are BPMN 2.0 is the latest trend. So we are planning to have some custom activities and also some extensions for API manager. Okay, so community contribution. So we always encourage users to contribute to our code base. And also this is the best part, because these extensions are like catering a specific aspect. So you can just really focus on that aspect and build your extension. So, and also we support a lot of details like how to do it within this documentation link. So currently we have done that for all the extension we release. So following these links, you can just simply create your own extension and publish in our store. So what are the advantages of contributing? The one point is mainly I find that most of our contributors are university students, customers, and our users. So maybe for university students, it's a good opportunity, because as a middleware, we have set of products which are covering a lot of aspects on middleware. So based on their interest, they can select a product and do extension on that. So, and also for customers, if you contribute with us, so we make sure that it is compatible across all product versions. So that way you all be benefited from that. And if you have any further questions, you can just use these mail threads as we discussed, Samisa mentioned during his first talk. So that brings us to the end of my talk. So in summary, so WSO2 helps you to build platforms. So with using extensions, you can build the solutions in a faster way. And we also encourage and necessary guidelines to contribute to our space. Okay, thank you very much for this.